submit. Okay.
I feel like a singer-songwriter. Bom dia. Good morning, everybody. So I would like to ask you to go to the website and download this file and then extract it. Has everybody done this already while we were starting up? I will also do it myself. So it's this file. And it's just like yesterday, you extract it, and there's a blue icon. Extract here. And then you double click on the blue icon, and then it opens RStudio, and then everything is set. Zoom in a bit. Okay, download and extraction worked. And I want to ask you to please open this file. The install packages.r, and then to run this code, because we'll install a number of packages from the internet, from the CRAN website that we're going to use today and tomorrow, and this will take a few minutes. So if you just run the code, then in the meantime I will do the introduction, and your laptops will be downloading and installing in the meantime. So it's in this file here, install.packages, install_packages. Oh, yeah, it's just on the edge of the board, right? this one. You have it? So just control enter, somewhere put your cursor here, control enter, and it will start installing. Found it? If not, because we're going to do some practical exercises, I can come over and help you after the introduction when we start doing some scripts. So then just raise your hand in a few moments when I'm putting you to work, and then I'll come and help you. There. Any problems you want me to help you with now? Okay, let me give a short introduction, and then I'll what we're going to do. And yes. Ah, you have to log in. Oh, yeah? Great. Okay, then so before I'm going to let all of you do the hard work, I just want to bring this picture back. So until now we've been talking mostly about data management and reproducibility and how to systematically set up a data analysis using this ID from a statistical value chain. And in this lecture and tomorrow's lecture, we're going to dive in a little bit more into the first two parts, the data cleaning part. And what I'm hoping to convince you of is that, you know, data cleaning seems like a quite messy process in itself. You know, there's strings to be cleaned up, there may be different units, there may be invalid data, there may be like data missing. And the thing that I will try to convince you of is that you can bring some order to this chaos and separate out some clearly defined different tasks in data cleaning. And then once you can recognize those tasks, hopefully it also becomes easier to focus on separate tasks and separate, you know, cleaning issues. So in today's lecture and tomorrow's lecture, we will see some tools in R that you're going to execute and use around a little bit. And I will try to give you some background and some principles in how you can try to recognize different subtasks. And then hopefully that will help you to organize your data cleaning tasks better. Okay, so the format of the workshop is as follows. First, I don't tell you anything. I give you about maybe 10 minutes to open this file, and then one by one, just execute the code that's in there. So I will just show you where it is. If you manage to open this, we can close this file. And under input, there's a file JSON cleanup. And then you can, if the installation just worked, if not, then just raise your hand. Try to execute this code. You will see some output. And then please discuss with your neighbor, because it's really valuable to try to understand this together with the person you're sitting next to. And see if you can make sense of what is actually happening from reading the script and executing it. And then after 10 minutes, I will show you through the script and give you some background in what we have been doing. But hopefully you will also understand most of it just by experimenting with it a little bit. And so we do a couple of those sessions, I think two of these before the break, and then one longer one after the break, and then tomorrow we have a few of these sessions again. And the idea is we have, maybe I'll tell you a little bit of the background of the data we have. We have data in both in JSON format and in XML format. It's data on companies. We have some financial data in JSON format, and we have some like name and address data of the companies in XML format. And what we're going to do this morning, before the break, is to read in those data sets and to make sure that we match the data in the JSON format with the data in XML, and we get a nice rectangular table of data. All clean, almost good to go. Yes. Say no. So open the file and try to run, and please discuss with your neighbor what you see and if you can make any sense of it. If you have any problems, just raise your hand and I'll come down and try to help you. Yes. Okay. Okay, after the ordeal of installation, I think most of you can now run the script. So what I want to do now is just show you what is in the script. So the idea is to, you know, read the comments, execute the... the beamer is turned off. Execute the commands and then discuss with your neighbor and see if you can understand what is happening and why it's happening. So I'll give you some background and then we can have a break. Let's see if we get the beamer up. Yeah. So we have some raw data. I can open it and it looks like this. Similar to something I showed you on the first lecture, right? It could be data that you download from IBGE, for example, that comes in this kind of format and you download it automatically. Right, so this is not suited for analysis, and our task is to bring it into a format that is suited for analysis. So in R there is this library called JSONLite, and that allows us to read in JSON files, just like this. You just have to say read JSON, and then we can actually look at the structure. Okay, so here's the thing that I just read in. And a JSON file is just, it's a nested list, right? It's a list of items, and each item can be a list again. And in there are the values and the names are connected to the values. So that's a really, you know, inconvenient way to analyze data, right? You usually want the rectangular format. So I can look at it by clicking here. Another thing I can do in R, to look at the structure of a data that you have just been reading in, is use the str command. So that's what you see here. I'll scroll up. Can I scroll up enough? Yeah. What you see here is, I just typed str companies raw, what I just read in, and it tells you, oh, there's a list of 60 items, and the first item is a list with 5 items. First item is called name, is of type character, and it says Jetstar, that's the name of the company. The second item is called staff, is also character, so it's text, and the value is 75, and so on and so on. So that's a structure as we got the data, say, from IBGE. Or you can, in R, there's another option to view any kind of data, to type view with a capital V. And then you can get this somewhat nicer view on the same stuff, and you can click and open, and so you can see what's in there, right? So the data that you obtain like this, which is hard to read, we can now already at least browse through it a little bit, right? To get to know a little bit what's in there. Okay, so that's one way to do it, and then this... If you're lucky and the JSON is very regularly structured, so it's a list of items and all the sublists have the same structure, you can turn it into a data frame, into a rectangular format automatically. And then I do the same thing as above. I just give it this extra argument, simplify vector is true. And now you can see that it was read in and transformed to something rectangular. It's not always as easy as this, but of course this is an example that we made ourselves. So we can look a little bit at the data. And so what you see, we have names of companies, we have staff numbers. There's something strange going on here because we have some numbers and there's a question mark here. So that means this column is actually not formatted automatically into numbers, because a number cannot be a question mark, or a question mark cannot be a number. So R understands that this column is now text. So we, in other words, we cannot compute the average number of staff per company, for example. Not yet. So that's part of the cleanup tasks, right? One is to get it into the right rectangular format. And now we have to make sure that all the types of data are in the correct, are correct, right? And then you see there's a whole bunch of missing data. We have some very nice data here on, for example, the profit of each company, but unfortunately it's reported with a unit in there. So it says kilo euro or thousands of euros. It's not a kilogram of euro, euros. So that means, again, this is text, right? We cannot do calculations with it yet. Right? We can just look at it, but we cannot do anything meaningful like make a plot of profit against turnover, because R still thinks this is text. So after, let's say, rectangularizing the data, our next task is to see if we can get all these types correct. Now, so we're going to do this step by step, so you can see a little bit the commands that R has available to do this kind of operation. So there's an operation in R called s.integer, which you give it one column, and it gives you, and it tries to translate that column to integer wherever possible. So what I do here is I take the rectangular data set that we just created, companies raw, that's the name of the data set, and then the dollar tells me, okay, now I take one column from there and I take the column staff and I give that to s.integer, and then the result I store in a separate variable that I call staff here. So I run it, and now it gives me a warning, you see? I have to maybe put this up a little bit. So in R, the technical term for translating some kind of data, text, to numbers, for example, or from numbers to text, in R this is called coercion. You coerce from one type to another, from text to categorical data, from text to numbers, from numbers to text. You can call it conversion. In R this is called coercion. And what it says here is NAs introduced by coercion. That means there were some values in that column that could not be translated to numbers. And that's logical, I think, because you see this is the column, it has 75, 9, and then there is a question mark. Right? We cannot translate this to a number in any meaningful way. So what it does instead is give you a missing value. So everything it can convert, it will convert, and what it cannot convert, it will leave this, make this missing. And that's what the warning is about. It says I could not translate everything. So I can show you the first six values of the converted column. Move it up a little bit. So we have 75, 9, and then na. It's not a song. That means not available. Okay. So that what we can do now is add this column back to the original data set. Okay. So we could do something like this. Staff, and well, maybe this is more clear. I could just overwrite it with a converted one, like this. So this is I take a column that exists and I overwrite it with the converted values. That's what's happening here. You get the warning, but now you see I have something that I can take. I can do now something like this, for example. The mean of I can now compute the mean of the staff, and I have to tell it to skip missing values. Yeah. If I ignore the missing values, then the mean is about 11.5 staff members per company. Right. So now I can start analyzing the data set, but that's only after you coerce to the correct type. Yeah, okay, what you see here is what I just told you. We can also put them side by side, the original and the converted values. Okay, so in R you have these functions called s.integer, s.numeric for numbers that have values behind a comma, say, for fractions. There's s.character to make something into text. And there's a few more, so you can actually translate this these different types into each other where possible. So that works pretty well for, let's say simple cases where we have like a question mark or like something like an empty string, like two quotes. But for here, s.integer is not good enough because it sees there's a k in there and a euro symbol, and it just will not tell me how to convert. It will convert basically everything to missing. But we are lucky that there is a package called Reader, if you manage to install it, because it has quite a lot of dependencies. It has a function called parseNumber. So we can compare. Let's take the turnover, for example. I can do s.integer of turnover. So here are all the, if I try to use s.integer on the turnover column, here's the original. Right, this is the original data. I just now show one column here in the output. You can see everything is text, basically. Right. If I try to use that s.integer trick again, it will translate everything to No. Right? Everything is text. Nothing can be converted. Because it doesn't understand that it should delete this part of the text and then convert. Now the readr package, if you load it, gives you an extra function called parseNumber that does understand that numbers can sometimes be polluted with things like a unit behind it or like a dollar sign in front of it. It recognizes a whole bunch of like common cases. So let's try that one. Turnover. And now we get numbers. So the parseNumber from the readr package is a very good one to have seen once. And now we can compute, for example, the mean turnover. I can give this to the mean. I have to still... There's still some missing values that I have to ignore, but then you see the mean turnover is 2134. Okay, then this command is just a trick to do this for a whole bunch of columns at the same time. Yes. The dot here is like a comma, so it's 25. The quantity here is 25, and the dot 000 is like it's just how it's representing numbers with figures behind the comma. Yeah. That's a difference. I mean, they follow the American convention and the European convention, and maybe also in Brazil. I don't know actually. Is financial amounts are usually denoted with a comma, right? 25 and a half euro is 25.5, 50. But this follows the U.S. convention. That's common usually also in programming. Yeah. Okay, so then this command, I will not go into this, but this is just a way to do this for a bunch of columns at the same time. So I say column 3 to 9. L apply means basically treat columns 3 to 9 with parseNumber, and then I plug that back into the original data set. I don't expect you to be able to reproduce that, but that's just a very quick way of doing it. And now we can write our CSV file. We can write our data out, because now we have everything is rectangular, and everything is in the correct type. That's the ID. I think it's time for a break. Let's have 10 minutes break. Okay, everybody? In the last 20 minutes or so, I would just like to discuss and just demonstrate to you one other very common task in data cleaning, I think. That's matching data that where you don't have an exact key. So imagine, for example, you have names of people or names of companies, in this case, in one file. And one file here will have some financial information on every company, like turnover and profit and costs and number of staff. And we have another file where we have like an official identity code for the company and the name and something like name and address and things like that. So that's what we call the backbone. It's like a register of companies with some basic information. And then we have like the actual data that we want to connect to that, right? The problem is that one file, the file with the data, does not have the identification number of the company. So what we have to do to match those records is to look at the name and match on the name. And the problem is that we often find spelling errors in data that's entered like that. So I will just run the code and tell you what you see. Let me just first show you the two files, so then it's a bit more clear what I'm talking about. To make it more explicit. So this is the backbone. So we have an identifying number. There's a company, Lucky Aviation. There's a street number, a zip code, city, and so on. And this we consider, like, this comes from the Chamber of Commerce, say, and this is rock solid, right? We have this comes from a register, and everything is spelled perfectly, and it has a unique ID. And then on the other hand, we have this data that we obtained from somewhere else. Could be from a survey, or we could have been scraping the internet, or we bought it somewhere from somebody who collected the data somehow. And looks like this. So we have the names of companies. But you see, for example, here we have Grasshopper Entertainment, but there's a spelling mistake. There's a space, it's not between the R and the E, but it's between the E of Grasshopper and the final R, right? So this is maybe human typed data, and people make typing mistakes. So it's very common, this kind of case, I think, where you have names and address data, for example, or just name data, but not a unique identifier. So what we have to do is take these dirty names here and try to match them with these perfect names. And then for everybody, for every record, if we succeed, for every record we have the ID, the name, the street, and also the financial information together. So we can analyze that together. Right? So you can look, for example, at the average profit per city. And you enrich the data. So the idea here is that if the names would be spelled perfectly over here in our dirty data, then I could look at the first name and then search through this column here where I find exactly the same name and say, ha, these two records match together. This is called a join operation. And if you work with databases, this is like people do this all the time. So that works fine in cases where your data matches perfectly, but as said, we have spelling errors. So what we are going to do is not to try to find an exact match, well, exact match if there is one, but otherwise we're going to try to leave a little bit of distance between the two things that we match. We want to try the two names that are as close to each other as possible. Now, as soon as somebody says as close as possible, you have to start thinking, how do I measure that, right? What does it mean for two pieces of text to be similar? And it turns out there are different ways of defining that, different ways of measuring that, and depending on what the cause of the error is and what types of errors are made, you may want to choose a different method of measuring that. So I'm going to use a library or package, called StringDist. And let's just explore a little bit. There's a function called StringDist in this package, and that gives you the distance between two strings. This shows you how dissimilar they are. So here are two strings, hee-hee and hee-hee-hee. And there is a distance of 2, right? Why should it be 2? Does anybody have any idea? Yeah, 2 extra letters, right? It's a variant of it. How about between hihi and haha? 2. Yeah. So in the first case, we had to add 2 letters, right, to go from one to the other. And in this case, we have to replace 2 letters. So apparently, replacing 2 letters is the same amount of distance as adding 2 letters in the end. Or in the beginning, you don't really see which one is which. Here is hihi and ihhi. What would you think would be the distance? Yeah. 2 again? Or 1? Yeah. In this case, it's 1, yeah, because we allow also to be 2 characters that are close to each other to be transposed. It's called transposition, right? And then between hello and hello with a capital H, we also get 1 because it's case sensitive. Then there's a small exercise here, so. Yeah, let me first just then go into a little bit what it means to measure these distances. Where's my... Okay, so... The StringDist package allows you to measure the difference between 2 strings. And it also allows you to find, given one string and a list of other strings, give me the one that is closest somehow. But then there are different ways to measure how close they are. And I'll talk about 2 of them. So here's a StringDist between Ross Iacca and Robert Gentleman. Does anybody know who these people are, by the way? If you're using R, you should at least hear these names once. They are the ones who developed R for the first time in the early 90s. Original R authors. Yeah. So let me first say something. Yeah. So how would you match? How would you match 2 columns? Right. Here I have a lookup table that's just a column of data with my perfect names. So I'm doing a very simple example now, and I'll do it on the bigger data set later. So I have Alice, Bob, Carol, and Danny. And here's my dirty data column. I have Bob, Carl, Rob, Bob in small letters, and so on. So they don't all match exactly. And how you would do this in R, or one way to do this in R, is to first ask this function called match. You say, here I have my raw data. Try to match it exactly with lookup. So what it does, it takes this first value, Bob, and checks, can I find it here? No. Can I find it here? Yes. Okay. So it gives me back number 2 and stores it here. Then it looks here, Carl, can I find it here? No. 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 Can't find it, right? So it doesn't match everything. It only matches exactly. And then by using this little trick here, I can see what's the raw data and which one have been matched. I put it now together in a rectangular data frame. But the most important idea is here, we're doing exact lookup. For each element in this column, I'm going to try to match it with one here. And you can see here the results. So Bob is matched, Carl is not matched, Rob is also not matched. and Bob, little Bob, and Dan also not, and Alice is matched again. So we could only find two out of, how much is it, six. And the question is, can we do a little bit better if we allow some spelling errors between the raw data and the lookup table? So that's where the stringdist package comes in. It gives you a function called amatch for approximate matching. It has exactly the same look, or it looks exactly, it works exactly the same as match. You give it the raw data, you give it the, let's say, pure data. And you say, okay, two things can match if they are maximally two typing arrows apart. So you can like add an extra letter, or you can delete an extra letter, or you can do two transpositions, but maximum two. And the idea is that, okay, if this is typed by humans, I don't think that it's very plausible that they make more than two typing errors in the same name, for example. Okay, so then I do exactly the same code, and then you see that now we can match everybody, right? This is using approximate matching. The number of typing errors between Carl and Carol is only one. We have to insert one O. Between Rob and Bob is also one. We have to replace one R with one B. And so we can still make a match. Of course, now you're doing approximate matching. So in actual real data sets, you will get maybe false positives if you allow this maximum distance, the maximum number of typos, to be too large. You might get false positives. And if you make it too small, you may get like false negatives, right? So it becomes kind of a classification problem. And you probably have to run it a few times at a few settings to see which one serves your purpose best. And often you will never get a 100% correct match, but maybe you can get 95%, and the other 5% you may have to do manually, or you can throw it out. Right? So there's a huge gain already from doing this manually. Is that clear? What's going on? Yeah. Okay. So now the question is: the algorithm I used here is called optimal string alignment. It is a variant of the Liebenstein distance, or a variant of the Damerau-Liebenstein distance, as you said there in the back. Because there are many ways to think of how can I measure the difference between two pieces of text. So the optimal string alignment counts typos, where a typo is inserting a letter, deleting a letter, swapping two letters that are next to each other, or substituting a letter. Sorry, there was one more. Yeah. So now let's look at this one. The distance between Robert Gentleman and Gentleman, Robert is 15, right? But it's not very likely, I think, that this is because of a typo, right? You don't make a typing mistake on your keyboard and then swap the last name and the first name. It's just a different way of spelling the same information. So using the typo distance, let's call it typo distance, or this optimal string alignment distance, is not always the best way to measure the difference between them. And you can even see that Robert Gentleman is closer to Ross Ihaka than it is to himself, and Gentleman, Robert in this case. So you get a false match. So I'm going to give you one other alternative. It's called cosine distance. And basically what you do here is you take the first string, for example, Robert Gentleman, and you go from left to right, like this, and you count how often do I see RO, how often do I see OB, how often do I see BE, how often do I see RT, how often do I see T space, and so on and so on. So you count how often you see each pair of characters. That's the first step. You do that for the first one, and you do that for the second one. Now you can imagine if you have the table of pairs of characters, they're not so different between this one and this one. Because both of them have the GE, both of them have the EN, both of them have the NT. The only difference is that one has an N comma that this one doesn't have, and a comma space that this one doesn't have, and a comma R that this one doesn't have. But all the other things occur, right? So you just have a sliding window across, and you tabulate how often do I see a pair of characters. It's called a Q-gram profile. It has a name. But the name is not important. The ID is the most important. And this ID makes you more or less insensitive to the order of words. Yeah, so that's why it says Q equals 2, because you can also count triplets, like how often do I encounter ROB, OBE, BER, ERT, and so on. Or you can just count characters, and you set Q equals 1. And then you just count how many R's, O's, B's, E's, R's, and T's. Right? So there's different ways to tabulate. But the point is, now you are not sensitive anymore, or a lot less sensitive to the order of words. Okay, so what you get is a list of numbers. A list of numbers for this one, counting the occurrences of pairs. A list of numbers for that one, and then you can compare these two lists and see how well they match. So what you do is what is computed here is something that's called a cosine distance. What it is exactly is not so important. What matters is it scales from 0 to 1, where 0 means they are completely different. 0 means they're exactly the same, sorry. And 1 means they are completely different. So here we have 16% difference between Robert Gentleman and Gentleman Robert. And, with using this method, we have 90%, 91% difference between Robert Gentleman and Rossi Haka. Okay, so depending on the type of errors that you expect in the pieces of text, you have to choose either optimal string alignment, if it's like human-typed data and you expect that there could be some, you know, fat finger mistakes, pressing the wrong key, basically, switching to letters. Or if it just comes from a different source, because some databases will write names in this order and some databases will write names in that order. To give a few other cases where this one has been applied successfully, in cases where I've worked on, is for example product descriptions. Right? You can have like a red bicycle or a bicycle, comma, red. And so that's different ways of describing products. Both cases occur. So you have to choose the correct way to compare the strings, and then you can do the matching. Yeah. So how to do it with AMatch is as follows. You use it just like I showed you in the example before. You give it the raw data, the lookup, the pure data. Then you tell it what method, for example, method equals cosine. And you tell it what is the maximum distance that I accept. So two things can still be considered the same. And that's something you just have to experiment a few times with and see what comes out and how well it works. And the same with the Q parameter. 2 or 3 is usually a very good place to start. 3, I think, is most used. Okay. Let's see if I can demonstrate this with the companies. I read this in here. So I do the match on the companies. And if I just match on... let's see, do we have a company name? So what I do here is I take the dirty data, companies, dollar name. So that's the dirty data. And here's my pure data, the actual company name as it is registered. And I try to match it using the standard match function, and I only get exact matches. And then I compare the backbone with the companies, that with the dirty companies, and put everything together. And I just have to read. It's the name variable. Oh, it's nothing here. You see, I get a lot of like records with a lot of missing values. So that's where things couldn't be matched. Right? That's what happened. I could match only, I don't know, maybe 50% of them. Or another way to view it would be like this. Like, this is my dirty data, and this is what I could match. A lot of things are missing. Right? With exact matching. And then we can start playing around, like using a match. I will just do copy. I will just give you 1 or 2 examples. use a match. Max list equals 2, for example. Okay, so now I do exactly the same as I showed you in the slide. You don't have to remember it, but now I'm giving the companies like 2 typos of slack. And then this is what it looks like. This is my originally matched data. This is the data where I accept 2 typing errors. So you can see that, let's see, one that was not matched. Here, Blizzard. So dirty data is matched with a company called Blizzard, right? The R is inserted and we accept it. So we get a lot more matches here. Then of course, if I just... increase like the maximum allowed distance to, let's say, 20, you're almost always going to have a match and some of them will be false. The last one I will show you. You see, now I always match, but there's a good chance that there are some false matches in here, and I think probably some of them are. Here's something really strange, for example. So that's the basic workflow. You do a lookup, you allow some slack, and you put them back together. The most important thing I want you to remember is that it's possible to do this kind of matching. You always have the example here that's online, so you can always, if you need it, you know, look it up and try it on this data and then try to plug in your own. It's always a good idea to start with somebody else's script and then adapt it for your own needs. Is this clear so far, conceptually? It chooses the first one with the smallest match. Yeah. So in a, it depends on the order of your column. That's a good question, actually. Yeah. So if you find multiple matches with the same distance, it will just give you the first one it finds. Yeah. It mimics the behavior of match, of base R, the standard R match, in that sense. Yeah. If you want all matches, there is a function called, well, you can just compute all the distances yourself using the string dist function and not the amatch function, and then see how many are double. So then you could do some analysis on that. Yeah, and it's a little bit more involved. One thing that you need to be aware of is that, one thing that is part of an analysis such as this, is you can take the pure data and look at the distances between the strings in the pure data. Then you can see what's the minimum distance between them. Right, and any distance low below that, you will not get a false match, most probably. Okay. Well, thank you for joining again. Tomorrow we will go into the content of data. We're going to do data validation systematically, and we're going to work with missing data and try to estimate missing values. I'm going to send an email. If this download worked, you should be fine. But I'll send an email with a command in any case to be sure.